Hello, I'm Matt Kelly.
And I'm Matt D'Ancona.
And this is the two Matts for the week ending Friday the 7th of June. And this is episode, guess what number this is?
50.
Oui, oui, mon brave. Episode 50, this is.
Episode 50.
God,
half a century.
What did we talk about?
Well, we talked about lies and dishonourable politicians, and then we talked about great people.
We talked about honourable
veterans who honour us by what they did.
They did, the greatest generation. Some
so it's a real great. Bad and good versus good episode. It really is.
So this is anyway the two Matts, episode 50. Enjoy. So, Matt, how did you enjoy or otherwise the TV debate, the big TV?
Well, I ingested it. I'm not sure I enjoyed it. But it's interesting, isn't it? Because what a week it's been, because it kicked off with Farage saying he was going to stand for Clacton, as we said in our first election podcast. And then, I mean, what really this debate between the first leaders' debate between Starmer and Sunak, up in Salford, ITV News, Julie Etchingham, moderating it, has sort of become the liar stroke tax debate, in which, you know, our glorious if diminutive prime minister was caught with his romper suit on fire, right? So maybe if producer Matt could give us a blast of his claim, and then we can chat about it.
Independent Treasury civil servants have costed Labour's policies and it's £2,000. But you asked for specifics,
nonsense.
Julie. So let's have
absolute
a specific difference.
Nonsense.
Please let Mr. Sunak finish.
The triple lock plus.
It's
so that we raise the personal allowance for pensioners and ensure that the state pension is never subject to tax.
So that was that, and he said it 11 times, this £2,000 figure. And Starmer made a mistake because he didn't really knock it down until about 26 or 25-6 minutes in, and then he said it was garbage. But by that stage it had run, and so there was this massive, you know, rearguard action by Labour spinners and shadow ministers to make clear it was bullshit, and it was.
And I mean, the civil service themselves.
Well, this is the thing, is that, you know, Sunak, you know, lie is a word not to be thrown around lightly, but this was a lie. Sunak said it was independent Treasury officials. It turns out it was just a dossier that Jeremy Hunt, the Chancellor, had organised, because they have this power, ministers, which I think, in fact, really is a power that needs looking at, which is they throw their assumptions about something at civil service officials, and civil service officials put it through the machinery and say, well, this is what it means. And there are meant to be lots of health warnings attached to these figures.
But just to explain, as I gather, and I might be wrong,
they
don't have to say what the purpose of this is. They don't have to say
to the
Treasury officials,
no,
we want to stitch up Labour, give us a big number.
They just say...
They say, if this and this happened, what would the effect...
Specifically in this case, the Conservative Special Advisers at the Treasury drew up what they thought were a series of guesstimates of what the spending pledges thus far of by the Labour Party would be. And then the Treasury machinery spat out the figure 2,000, which, by the way, which Sunak didn't make clear, is over 4 years.
And this is the most insidious thing.
Which is such an insidious thing, because whenever anyone mentions a tax figure, it is assumed to be annual. But, I mean, they just made up things. Like, one of the things Labour is proposing is to insource a lot of things that have been unsuccessfully outsourced to the private sector. And the Tory special advisers just assumed that anything done by the private sector is 7.5% more efficient. Well, says who?
Yeah.
You know, and they costed Labour's Breakfast Club's promise at 4.5 billion. Who says?
Yeah, yeah.
So in other words, the document is literally worthless.
Yeah.
And as you said, I mean, even though Claire Coutinho, the energy secretary and a protege of Sunak's, carried on saying it was the independent civil service.
I mean, she doubled down. Well, she
did.
So if you replay the clip, Sunak is the semantics of what he says, you can unpick in a version where he says, no, I didn't specifically say that £2,000 had come all from the Treasury officials.
Right.
But Claire Coutinho then, on the Today programme, said, oh no, it absolutely did.
So,
Gus O'Donnell on the same Today programme was absolutely raging.
It was brilliant. And I mean, Gus O'Donnell, former cabinet secretary, former permanent secretary at the Treasury, just tore through this.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, a letter emerges, which had been sent to Darren Jones. This wasn't the civil service trying to make trouble, but Darren Jones, Labour's shadow chief secretary, had written to James Bowler, the current permanent secretary at the Treasury, saying, you know, what's going on with this dossier? And James Bowler had said, you know, civil servants were not involved, quote, were not involved in the production or presentation of the Conservative Party's document, Labour tax rises, or in the calculation of the total figure used.
Yeah.
I mean, that is a lie.
Yeah.
And I think it's really important that it be called it. And I was pleased to see Starmer finally came out used the L word.
So there were two things about it. One is Sunak's willingness to lie, which is absolutely reprehensible, especially when you remember the bullshit he came out with when he started.
Oh, yeah, what was
it? I mean, all about the, you know, transparency.
He said
accountability.
Integrity, professionalism and accountability at every level. This was in October 2022.
So
when he became,
that was a lie about a lie. His propensity to tell lies in the future. The man is a liar. I think Starmer was right about saying he had his back to the wall. But that gives the impression that Starmer had somehow put him into a terrible position in this, by the way, dreadful format, this debate format.
It really
absolutely
doesn't work.
Utterly pointless hour of TV, which he hadn't. You know, I thought they were both fairly unimpressive. But where the reality of it is Sunak did have his back to the wall, but only because he's 21 points behind in the polls. And he deliberately contrived this lie beforehand.
Yes.
And yes, he may have won, because if you remember, straight after the debate, there was ambivalence about who had won the debate. You know, 51% Sunak, 49% Starmer. Different polls said different things. But the thing that everyone was talking about was the 2,000 quid. And everyone said, oh, well, that's going to stick. And he may have won that little battle, but the 2,000 quid will become the war that he loses, because he's been exposed now.
Well, it's a very interesting thing, isn't it? Because this tactic is very venerable in politics. And the classic example is Lyndon Johnson. And I think it's an apocryphal story, actually. I think Hunter S. Thompson made it up. But the story goes that Lyndon Johnson, in one of his early races in Texas, was having a tight race. And he said to his campaign manager, let's accuse the other guy of being a pig fucker. And the manager said, Christ, we can't get away with calling him a pig fucker.
Was it David Cameron?
Well, of course, that connection has been made in the past. Nobody's going to believe a thing like that. And LBJ replies, I know, but let's make the son of a bitch deny it. So the idea is if you're explaining, you're winning, right?
Yes.
That's the old argument.
Yeah.
And that you get Labour talking about tax, and they have invested, as we have said repeatedly on the pod, a lot of energy, maybe too much, in saying they won't raise income tax, they won't raise VAT, except on school fees, they won't raise wealth taxes. It's what the tobacco industry called the merchants of doubt tactic, which is you just sow doubt.
Yeah.
So that was the plan, and we're recording this on Thursday, and Jeremy Hunt has written a piece in the Daily Telegraph challenging Starmer not to increase capital gains tax, stamp duty, or a number of council tax bans. So we can see where this is going. And we mentioned in online in the New European the comparisons with the $350 million
on the bus.
Brexit.
And the debate has taken on this kind of meta quality now, isn't it? Which is about, especially amongst the journalists, about, is it right to even talk about the 2,000 quid now that we know it's bullshit?
Yes.
Should we even be talking
about it? Well, I think it is. But I think that what the difference, I mean, there are lots of differences. A lot has happened since 2016 to public perceptions of public standards in public life.
Yeah.
I think that this illustrates the importance of calling a lie a lie. You know, one of the great problems in the referendum was, you know, the kind of caution around wanting never to appear to be on one side or the other. Well, you should be on the side of the truth. And that was a lie, what they put on the side of the bus. And I think there's been a bit less caution this time round of actually saying, you know what, this is a dodgy dossier. Mm. You know, we've got to call it out. But you're right. There is a, particularly for lobby journalists who are beat journalists and therefore rely on access.
Yeah.
There is a reticence about saying, using the L word.
Which is when you think about it, it's absolutely appalling state of affairs.
It's craven. And I think to circle back to what you said, Matt, about what he, Sunak, said on the cobblestones of Downing Street before he walked into number 10 back in October 22. Part of his sell was, not only am I not Liz Truss, I know about economics, but nudge, nudge, I'm not Boris Johnson. I don't tell lies. You know, there will be no party gate with me. You'll get I'm a straight bat.
Yeah.
And, you know, he's one of the conspicuous things about the debate so far is about the campaign so far is Sunak will not talk about the Tory record. Every time someone asks him about the 14 years, he says, well, I'm more interested in the future than the past. I'll bet you are, mate. But,
I was listening to Rory Stewart on The Rest Is Politics making the argument. And, quite rightly, he says, you look at the numbers, you look at what John Curtis says. The Sunak's whole chance was blown by Liz Truss. So he never really had a chance. You know, Liz Truss destroying the economy, it was over. And Rory Stewart seemed to be implying that this is why he is acting with such abandon with facts and the truth. And, he's in a desperate situation. But I was just sitting there thinking,
hang on a minute.
If you know you're beat, then why would you compound the offence by perpetuating what got your party beat in the first place? Why wouldn't you just say, as he did, I'm going to be honest, but then actually deliver on that?
So what has he actually done? I mean, he has embraced with disastrous consequences culture wars with the totally failed Rwanda policy, which is just, I don't know what the latest bill is. It was 550 million at one point.
That's right.
Misspent, wasted on nothing. And he's now, I think, moved into the terrain of, of just telling outright lies. Now, is taxation, should taxation be part of the debate in the final 5 weeks of the, is it, no, 4 weeks, 5 weeks of the...
Another 30 days.
Four weeks of the campaign. Yes, and I would like to see, and I hope the manifestos are much more revealing about how exactly, given the terrible numbers, both parties are going to propose to pay for and tax or borrow, whatever it is. And I think that, Labour does have questions to answer, but they're normal questions. Mm. They're questions about any party that looks like it's going to come into government, which is, hang on a minute, you're saying all this, but you want to do this. You say it's all going to be funded by growth. Where's the growth going to come from? That's in a week from now, I suspect, or thereafter, we'll be having that debate.
And by the way, I couldn't help but thinking, wouldn't it be a much better world where Keir Starmer was saying, damn right, I'm going to get another 2,000 quid off people over four years because we need to make this country better.
100%. Because, what I find dispiriting about all of this stuff about tax is that we know all the challenges that are coming down the road, from the growing burden on the NHS, on the social care system, which is a national scandal, the need for pandemic resilience, the need to really get our skates on climate change, the need to deal with technology. These are all high cost ticket things. This is going to be a century of the state. And that's a pragmatic thing. It's not an ideological thing.
Yeah.
There is going to have to be more tax or borrowing, but there is going to have to be that. And I do agree with you. I think that the real visionary, and Starmer is many things, but he's not that, would say, part of the hard times that I'm afraid I have to offer you are that there will be tax rises, and I will try and keep them at a minimum, but you, the public, and this is surely the point, are making clear in poll after poll and election after election and by-election after by-election that they are absolutely fed up with the state of the nation. I want to come into government. I want a decade of renewal, his words.
You want to repair the roof. There's a bill.
You cannot use Nigel Lawson's playbook from the 1980s to solve 2020's problems.
It's so weird.
Someone just has to say that.
There are two conspiracies of bullshit between both the parties. One is the fact that they're pretending that nobody's tax is going to go up.
Yes.
That's bullshit. The other is the absolute conspiracy of silence around Brexit. And, you know, Piers Morgan, who love him or hate him, is there on Newsnight saying what a lot of people aren't saying, which is, why is no one talking about Brexit?
Yeah.
Why is no one saying, if the majority of this nation wants a second referendum to judge the quality of what we've got 8 years later now, so it's not like this is some knee jerk, as Piers accused me of being guilty of, you know, by launching the New European straight after. But 8 years later.
8 years is a let's fair have a, old time.
And if we know that the 4% hit to the economy, you know, 100 billion quid, whatever it is completely down the drain, shouldn't we have an opportunity as a nation to say that's part of it? But how can we when neither main party will even discuss the topic?
Yeah, I mean, the idea of making Brexit work.
Yeah.
Is a bit like saying I'm going to make this chocolate teapot work. Yeah. It just doesn't anything.
I'm going to nail this jelly to the wall.
And I think exactly. And I think that in fact it's related to the whole tax lie issue, because anyone who thinks that we're going to get to the levels of growth that they keep talking about, the Labour Party outside the single market, needs their head examined. Yeah. You know, I mean, as a bare minimum,
yeah,
we need to be single market adjacent to get back. Claw back some of the disastrous losses of Brexit. And I mean, again, I always think it's best to frame these debates in a kind of pragmatic way, which is, look, Brexit's been a disaster. You know, you, the public, say you want more spending on the NHS. We agree. You say you want social care that works. We agree.
Yeah.
You know, you say you want schools where, you know, RARC isn't ruining the fabric of the of the classroom. We agree. But look, if we're going to raise the revenue that's going to pay for all that, and we mentioned climate change, we're going to have to get back into the single market. Mm. Now, you know, that may involve a very acrimonious row. But, I mean, here's the reality, which is that actually, if you look at the polls, it is now fairly clear that the Tories are headed to a very bad result at best.
Yeah.
You know, we're recording this on Thursday. YouGov polls just come out. And post Farage's announcement, Reform are now only 2 points behind the Tories, who are on 19.
Jesus.
Right? So Starmer will have a once in history opportunity to shape the debate, do what he wants.
Yeah.
Who knows what the next election will bring? I mean, the world, I mean, his Starmer's rise has shown that volatility is the only constant of the modern electoral landscape.
Yeah.
So he'll have 4 or 5 years in which to do
what
important stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, he might well win a second term, but who knows?
Well, the thing that I think characterises both of those conspiracies that I mentioned earlier is they're driven by a fear of a small part of the electorate, which is this idea of the red wall voter, which has become absolutely
homogenized red wall.
Nonsense, right?
As if there are all these people in a red wall who think all the way... I mean, it's a ridiculous concept.
Yeah.
People contain contradictions, for example. Yes, I mean, I think it is true that there will be some people who'll say, you know, this is overturning the will of the people. But I suspect that is a dwindling number. And I think even those people might be persuadable when they think about, you know, what they're seeing all around them. Because they were, in 2019, those red wall voters were promised, you know, gravy today.
Yeah.
They were they were duped as much as Leave duped the whole electorate in 2016, which was get Brexit over the line and your life will become better. Well, you know, it really hasn't.
Yeah.
And I think that the idea that the red wall, if we dared to talk about Brexit, would rise up as one.
Yeah, is it absolute nonsense? But it also
ridiculous.
doesn't it suggest a broader problem with politics in that we've now got you know, we live in a representative democracy.
Yes.
And the whole theory that underpins that, because it's not the only form of democracy, but the whole theory that underpins representative democracy is we elect somebody who then considers matters and
uses
takes
judgment.
Decisions on uses their
yes.
judgment on our behalf.
They're not, you know, they are. I can't remember what Burke said, but you know, yeah. they're representatives, not delegates.
Exactly, it's exactly that. But we now are acting as though they are delegates, but ill-informed delegates, and
yes.
delegates too frightened to ask again.
Yes.
You know, in case they don't like the answer that they get.
Yeah,
and the tail is now wagging the dog, and the tail being the polls, the theory, the. Anything other than doing the right thing for the right principle is now wagging the dog. You know, the quest for power has been wagging the Conservative dog for the last five prime ministers, you know, and they've taken decision after decision, not based in the interests of the country, but based in just the pursuit of power. And if they live to maintain that power, they live in fear of this abstract electorate, which is in total defiance of anything that the polls tell you is reality, where reality is 66% of people would have a second referendum
yeah.
tomorrow.
And, you know, to quote LBJ again, and this time it's a real quote, power is where power goes.
Right.
And so if Starmer wins anything like the majority he appears set for,
yeah.
he can really, I mean, more or less do what he wants. I mean, yeah, if he, let's just say on the first day, this is not going to happen, but on the first day of his premiership, he said, OK, I'm going to appoint a task force to look into the certainty of us joining the single market again and the possibility of that leading in due course and over time to membership.
Yeah.
Not rejoining,
yeah.
membership. The Daily Mail would go intercontinental ballistic missile nuclear.
Yeah.
So would any number of other outlets.
Yeah.
But Starmer is in that sweet, would be at that moment in that sweet spot where it just doesn't matter.
Where he could look at the Daily Mail and tell them to go fuck themselves.
You know, I mean,
they would be irrelevant at that point.
Okay, he says to Dacre, noted, and goes on.
By now, the way, I'm not even, do you know, as you were describing that, it would be a very interesting editorial conference at the Daily Mail because
they'd have to
sit there and they'd say, hold on, we need to be careful here because our readers, they're not all the people we pretend they are.
No.
You know, our readers are probably a lot more considered than we give them credit for. And they'll be sitting there thinking, well, do you know what? Maybe if I got the second chance,
look,
I'd take it.
Especially if the right, or the Tories anyway, are slaughtered in the way that
yeah.
they might be.
I
mean, if the Mailoverse, if you want to call it that, because it's not just the Daily Mail, there are all sorts of things that hover around it, similar media groups, both independent and mainstream. You know, if they all say treachery, trade, you know, they're betting on a quite small fragment of the population at that
yeah.
moment. Now,
yeah.
my point is that Starmer won't have that energy behind him
yeah.
forever.
No.
And this is in the same way that, and it's a much, much, much smaller U-turn, but the same way that when Major became Prime Minister in 1990, he was able to say, right, we're getting rid of the poll tax.
Yeah.
Because he had that.
That was the
that momentum.
Anchor weighing him
that,
down.
There,
yeah.
there we go.
That's right.
Now,
put that loose.
But this is, I mean,
yeah.
Starmer will have real rocket fuel.
Yeah. But is he the man to use it?
Well, you see, this is the problem, is that there is no evidence so far. I mean, he's a master of reassurance. I think we can put him down in history as the man who took the smoking ruin of the Labour Party in 2019 after its worst defeat since 1935 and brought it back, it looks like, into office. Massive historic achievement
yeah.
based on reassurance, getting rid of the anti-Semitic problem.
And a ruthless approach to carving out
absolutely
future.
Ruthless yeah. approach to yeah. both policy and faction and so on.
Yeah.
The big question is there anything within him that has the sort of, that slight, tiny fraction of recklessness
mm.
that makes truly great politicians.
And I was the other problem I had with the debate, just to bring it full circle, was obviously Sunak just laid his colours bare fine.
He was
but
so
Starmer,
tetchy.
But Starmer was so slow to just
he
absolutely
was,
cut
yeah.
him dead. And I was, you know, the guy's a top legal brain. He stands there at the dispatch box. He's you would imagine he's 100% across his brief.
Yeah.
And he just looked befuddled for about 20 minutes.
I mean, it was very odd because I thought, right, we're going to get a hedge funder versus a lawyer. And,
yeah.
and you know, not ideal, but that's what we're going to get. And I, like you, I expected Starmer's, I thought the problem would be he'd get too forensic. You know, he'd get he'd go, no, that's factually wrong because here are 15 statistics. Yeah. Actually, he was far too much on the back foot until quite a long way into the debate.
It seemed like he was kind of like caught off guard, which I'm sure
he was.
He probably was, but didn't have that instinctive debating quality to say bullshit. Bullshit, what are you talking about?
Yeah.
You know, that, absolute nonsense. And he finally, it worked through the mind after about 20 minutes and he finally was able to say, that's garbage.
I mean, one of the, you know, Biden, for all his flaws, one of his finest moments ever was in the 2020 debates. And Trump was just going on and on and on and on about Hunter Biden and all this. And Biden just lost it and said, oh man, shut up.
Yeah.
And that was it. That was the clip.
Yeah, the defining moment.
The defining moment. And I'm not expecting Starmer to say, oh, shut up, Rishi, ever. Yeah, but yeah. I wanted him to do something like that, which was to say, enough already. Mm. You know, you've had 14 years. It's a disaster. Yeah. And you have the audacity to fling these made up figures at me. You know,
you odious little twerp.
Go home, you know. I mean, it's go home to Santa Monica or wherever you're going to, you know.
Talking of which, before we move on, because we're going to talk in the second half about D-Day. A group of people who where courage isn't in dispute.
But yes.
I couldn't believe it when I saw in the FT yesterday that Sunak has put forward for honours Eric Schmidt, who was the former head of Google.
Yes.
And the head of JP Morgan Bank.
Jamie Dimon.
Can you believe it?
Well, I mean, it's basically...
The naked corruption of it.
I mean, it is basically using the honour system to apply for a job yourself.
Totally.
You know, it's sort of...
That's what I said on... I said it's a great icebreaker in August
when he's on a yacht and he says, so how's the... I mean, it is so shameless.
But, mate, honestly, can we just for a moment pause?
Yes.
I mean, in the sea of awfulness that's consumed us all over the last 8 years and longer, and think about what that says about the man that leads this country.
And
that
his contempt.
He's going to pin a medal on the chest of a bloke who used to run Google and lives in California.
Yes.
And as far as I've known, has done bugger all for this country.
No. I mean, and Jamie Dimon, who is Mr. Davos, you know, distinguished himself this year. Because Davos, they all say they hate populists, they hate Trump, you know, they're all about the corporate social responsibility and doing murals and all that sort of thing in Malawi. And then Jamie Dimon went out and said to, I can't remember who interviewed him, and said, well, you know, Trump will be okay. And I thought, that's the world these guys move in. Now, you know, he's one of the most successful bankers there has ever been, okay? But why he should be honoured by this country is absurd. And it shows a contempt for the ordinary voter, for the system of honours, for those before who have deservedly gained honours.
Yeah.
And it tells you really that what we all thought about Sunak, which is that he was a hedge funder on secondment to see how this democracy thing worked.
But I mean,
it's just true, it's, you know.
But he is a low operator. This
and I mean, it points to a broader problem to which I have no answer, which is that one of the really worrying things about politics in the last 10 years has been the growth of shamelessness.
Yeah.
You know, we saw it in Partygate. Trump incarnates it.
Yeah.
I don't know how you get back that. No. Well, honor once lost is very hard to retrieve.
It really is. And I suppose if you exist in a room full of 550 other shameless people, then
yes, that's the problem.
You think it's normal. You know?
You think it's normal. And I mean, I would say, in Starmer's defence, I think he probably is an honourable man. Actually,
yeah,
I think he is a decent man.
Yeah.
Most of the time so far, he's behaved very honourably.
Well,
so,
I mean, he could send a signal about that by one of the first things he could do is saying, "I'm going to reform the honour system." And,
well, he has said already, to his credit, that he will not do, if he becomes PM, he won't do a resignation honours.
Yeah, good for him.
Which I think is very much to his credit.
All right, enough.
That's enough lies for now.
Enough lies for the moment. We'll join you.
I'm sure there'll be more.
We're going to talk about the greatest generation after the break. So, D-Day, have you been following?
Well, I've been watching it, and 80th anniversary, and the extraordinary scenes from both this country and Normandy. You know, it's 80 years since Operation Overlord.
It's incredible.
Extraordinary, isn't it? And, you know, there's the king's there, Biden, Macron, Zelensky. Sunak's missing some of it, which I find very strange. Yeah. I mean, but let's not talk about him again. You know, and it's every time you hear it, blows your mind, because it, of course, now we think of it as a movie, which in which victory was inevitable, but it wasn't. You know, and 4,600 Allied troops killed, and it was 150,000 soldiers involved in a seaborne invasion under Eisenhower. Incredible endeavor. But I think, to me, I mean, it's always moving to see these things. But I was thinking about what it must be like for the veterans. You know, the youngest participant is 97.
Incredible,
amazing,
isn't it? And they were all the youngest of the younger.
Exactly.
They were all 18 or 19 or 20. You know.
I just thought, what must it, you know, 80 years ago, these incredibly young, brave, frightened men.
Yeah.
If you'd said to them, 80 years from now, you'll come back here to commemorate this, I mean, it would have seemed absurd. I mean, 80 years is longer than the life expectancy of someone born in 1994.
No, it's incredible.
That was 72, right?
And when you think about 80 years before D-Day, so if you think about the comparative spans of time.
That's a really good way of looking at it.
You know, that's 1860.
Yeah.
You know, so what's that? That's, I mean,
before the Second Reform Act.
Exactly. You know, so I mean, these are
massive
blips in the universal time.
Oh, but I mean,
but
in
human history, these are huge spans.
I mean, these people are walking history. They really are. And if you told them, not only are you going to be there, but the commemorations in Portsmouth and Bayeux and elsewhere will be watched live by millions, billions of people on small handheld devices.
That's right.
With they will call phones.
That's
right.
That's right.
Their minds would have blown. And those devices were the long term descendants of things that Alan Turing had secretly been doing when he broke the Enigma code. You know, I mean, their brains would have just been unable to quite understandably conceive this.
Yeah.
And that by that time, there would be wars going on in a country that didn't exist then. You know, the Israel-Gaza thing. Israel wasn't coming
to
being for four more years.
Yeah.
And another one that, in Ukraine, that was at that point still effectively a province of the Soviet Empire.
And that the bad guys, the protagonists in that war, were allies of
ours.
In the Second World War.
Don't forget, Putin came to the 2014 commemoration.
Yeah, of course.
You know, a lot has changed.
Yeah.
And all the things we take for granted. The United Nations, 1944, the United Nations, NATO, EU didn't exist. The guy who was in charge of the whole thing, Eisenhower, who'd only been a colonel at the beginning of the war.
Is that right?
He was only a colonel.
That's amazing.
8 years later, he would be president of the United States.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, we think of Eisenhower's presidency as being a very long time ago because it was. But to them, that would have just been what you mean the boss is going to be president.
It's
very strange.
Amazing. I was struck very much by I think it was the king that said, because I saw the headline, someone picked it out as a headline, the BBC maybe, the headline was, they did not flinch.
Yes.
But I have to say, I thought, bullshit, they flinched, and that's the point. They flinched, and then they went on. You know, that the horrific, scary nature of what anybody who's seen Saving Private Ryan, I think that's probably...
Or the Michael Caine Great Escaper.
Exactly,
film, you know.
But those opening moments.
Terrifying.
That will have been, near as damn it, what it was like.
Yes.
You know, and you think about those poor guys laden down with equipment, just jumping into the water, some of them drowning because they were weighed down so much with the gear. Incredible bravery. But
basically,
they must have been terrified.
They're basically what we would now call sixth formers, aren't they?
Yeah, son's 18.
They are.
And God bless him. You know, he's just got a job in Finsbury Park Cafe. And
right.
He's serving ice creams to people. And that's what those lads should have been doing.
No,
they weren't. They were jumping into fire.
Pulled out of towns and villages and, you know, and sent off into the jaws of hell.
But the other thing that I keep thinking about, which I don't think is reflected on enough, is just how much those losses defined us as a nation. Not in terms of values and all of this, which are all positive, we can talk about that, but in terms of the actual lives. I'll tell you a story. This is leading into a Matt Kelly story.
A Matt Kelly story.
My wife's grandfather died in Normandy, Alan Schofield.
Oh.
He was in a armed reconnaissance unit. and was killed near Cannes when a shell burst over his armoured car and killed him. He came from a village in North Yorkshire near Scarborough. And Nadia and I went to this church one summer. We had a holiday in North Yorkshire. We went to this church, and by absolute coincidence, there was a memorial to the three boys from this village who had died in Normandy. And there was Alan Schofield and his story told. And there was a newspaper clipping. And the newspaper clipping said, "We'll never forget how he visited us just a few weeks ago with his wife Marjorie. And they sang in the church choir." Amazing. And he had a two or three day furlough, and then he went off to Normandy. Yeah. Right. Now, what's amazing is that that visit was the night that my wife's father was conceived.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So he came home for his two or three days. They went to the church. They made love. Conceived and my wife's father. He went off. 2 weeks later, he was dead.
On these tiny turns of lives depend?
So Marjorie, his wife, was, as you can imagine, completely screwed up by that.
Of course.
Ended up in a psychiatric hospital in Glasgow, die. My wife's dad was completely screwed up by that. Ended up in, dying young in not great circumstances. And the expanding ripples of consequence from those events are enormous.
There's a psychological shrapnel, isn't there, that fires off. That's from great. These, yeah. And it goes down through the generations. Yeah. And I think that this sort of, a lot of ink has been spilt this week on, it's very important that we remember that land wars still happen in Ukraine. And I think we've talked about that on the podcast, and it's true. It is true, that... Sadly, it's not the case that kind of conflict is over, or at least not entirely.
Yeah.
But I also think that what you say makes me think about the broader issue of history. History has been, and how we remember things like this, has been under a lot of scrutiny, especially since 2020. And there's been a lot of positive things that have come out of that, because the death of George Floyd, and this may seem a stretched link, but bear with me, we've determined in lots of institutional forms we must be honest about the legacy of imperialism and of slavery and colonialism, and there have been heated debates about statues and commemorations and all that kind of thing. And books like Satnam Sangera's books have come out, and they've been very, very successful, and we've been kind of going through a corrective phase, I guess, where we face the whole, warts and all truth about the past. But I think the non sequitur that some people, not huge numbers, but some people fall into is that we have to adopt a year zero approach, and that the past, by definition, is something we have to kind of shrink from.
Yeah.
And honouring the past, some aspects of it, is somehow aligning yourself with all of the values of that time.
Yes.
That by honouring those in D-Day, we're not saying we agree with everything that was the case in 1944. Of course not. Mm. The nationalists and nativists often appropriate these events in a very disagreeable way. But I don't think that should stop us from celebrating what they did and honouring it and continuing to do so. And, it's like the circular argument about Churchill.
I was going to say,
Was Churchill suboptimal and did he do terrible things? 100%.
Yeah.
But he was also a great war leader, and you can contain, you should be able to, if you're an intelligent person, you should be able to contain both thoughts in your head at the same time.
And I think also when people spray paint on that statue in Parliament Square of Churchill... Yes. That statue, yes, it is of a man, but it's also of a time, and it represents a part of our history. The reason that statue's there is not because of all of his bad traits, which were manifold. The reason is because he led a nation.
Yes.
And as you say, that should be completely celebrated.
Yes, and we can be imaginative and intelligent in the way that we commemorate the past. Huge amounts of the values of 1944 shouldn't need to be stated, were of course totally different, and it's a long time ago and the world has changed completely. For a start, what's interesting, and there's a kind of odd echo, is that what followed was the election of a rather quiet decent Labour Prime Minister with, yeah, who rather wonderfully turned out to be a very radical Prime Minister, right. And that it would be rather nice if that repeated itself. I don't know if it will.
Do you think Starmer's the new Clement?
Well, I tell you that what I do think is this, is that I think Starmer is obsessed by Blair and Thatcher, and he should stop being obsessed by either of them and think about Attlee.
Yeah.
Because, Attlee hadn't, like Starmer, Attlee had no kind of charismatic skills.
Yeah.
But in the 6 years of his government, he transformed the country.
Yeah.
Those are basically the world we live in now in terms of public services was invented in those years.
That's
So that would be my model, whether he'll follow it.
But doesn't that show you, Matt? I mean, it's very interesting to think today's generation with the social media and the clips and the short attention span and the strange dynamic of how people think about politics today compared to how they obviously thought about it post-war. Is there any way they would have voted for Clement Attlee in immediately after the biggest victory of the British Empire,
against the most charismatic leader of his time?
He wouldn't have had a chance, would he?
I suppose not. Although I think that it is the case that people were, as they are now, but in times 100, so worn out and exhausted by the war effort that they actually amazingly dumped the war leader and opted for someone else. It's a very good question. I don't know. I really don't know.
Interesting. Anyway, God bless all those people on that beach.
Totally.
Do you think we'll still be commemorating D-Day in another 20 years?
Yes, I do. And I thought otherwise in 2014, actually, because it was very much being sold as, in the most benign sense possible, that's all, folks. And the fact that amazingly and wonderfully there are still some survivors has introduced this to a new generation, and in a world which unfortunately is chaotic and insecure and full of potential risk of conflict. So I think that there is a value to be attached to continuing to commemorate it, and it will be different in 20 years. Of course it will.
Yeah.
But there's no, I often hear this argument that Britain is obsessed by the Second World War, and I think there have been moments where we've kind of the endless reference to the Blitz spirit is silly. Do you remember in an early COVID people talked about the Blitz spirit, which is daft.
That's
But at the same time, that conflict was to date the greatest conflict there has ever been in human history. And the fact that the right side won is worth
remembering,
if nothing else. And also because of what you said, your amazing family story, because actually, the past isn't even past.
Faulkner said.
Exactly. We are living among the work of that generation and those that went before. Yeah. And coming to terms with it and changing our view of it, but continuing to commemorate that, which is good, is a good thing. And it's part of what a society is a kind of contract between past, present and future. And I think that it's terribly important in a world where we're so totally locked into the digital moment that we continue to keep our horizons as broad as we can.
Yeah, great. Well said. Brilliantly said. And on that note, we will bid you adieu. Hope you enjoyed the podcast this week, folks. Get your questions in, any feedback, to 2matts@tnepublishing.com. That's the number 2, matts@tnepublishing.com. We've had loads of feedback ever since the election special, so thank you for everybody.
Thank you very much for
that. We'll address some of those questions on Sunday. If you listen on Spotify, you can message us there. And that is what Jonathan Lefevre did. Hope I've pronounced that correctly, Jonathan, who says, if we really are to start kicking people out of the UK who can sail over on small boats, shouldn't we really start with the Huguenots and Farage's name being one of them?
Yeah, I mean, why not? Why stop there? Why not go back to Hengist and Horsa?
Yeah, the Beaker
people. And I mean, the Sutton Hoo treasures. Yeah. That boat looks suspiciously small to me.
If only we could reverse time and
grab, I know, you're very good with it.
Farage is great, whatever. Anti, yeah.
Okay. Monsieur Farage.
We will have more questions on Sunday and, of course, a brand new episode of our general election specials on Monday afternoon. If you've enjoyed this, please tell a friend, a colleague, a loved one, anybody. Spread the word and remember our subscription offer. If you like this podcast, you will love The New European. Head to theneweuropean.co.uk/2mats and get your subscription from just £1 a week plus a £25 voucher to spend in our shop. There's a link in the show notes. Thanks as ever to producer Matt Hill at Rethink Audio. And until Monday...
It's goodbye from me.
It's goodbye from him.
Goodbye.